Hello, this is David Heine. Today we're with Fabrice. I'm sure everyone that's walked around Amsterdam has at one point or another seen one of his paintings. This is the man that actually made them. So, Fabrice, could you tell me a little bit about how you got started here?
Yeah, first I was started on the Rijksacademie. It's the National Academy of Art in Amsterdam. And I was going to study painting, make sculpture things and all kinds of things. And before that school, I was working on a teacher school. And after the academy in 1985, I know very much people of the art world, of the museum and other international artists. But it was a difficult period because it was in the beginning of the 80s. So it was very difficult to start up and to find the good way to start up to success or sell your paintings or have enough aandacht. What is aandacht? Sorry, have enough aandacht. So there is at the moment I saw windows, I saw houses, I saw the whole city. And in the beginning of the 80s it was very much kraak atmosphere of crackers. Crackers, a typical Dutch word. Of people that they smashed paint on the walls. Amsterdam was a little bit more kind of a ghetto at the moment because the rich people, they are getting out from Amsterdam. So it was a little bit the doom period. And I didn't like doom. I didn't like things without music, but only raw punk music. I don't like punk music. I like at that time I liked soul music, and I like color, and I like erotic things. I like the life and that kind of thing. So I was going to make my first mural paintings on small walls and windows, and also it starts in the pipe, because in this neighborhood, it's in the south of Amsterdam. You have at that time you had very much hash coffee shops, so the government closed all the coffee shops because they thought there was things with hard drugs and not with soft drugs. And I make paintings on the wooden walls of all the hash coffee shops. So it looked like that the shop was open. So you saw people sitting there in the shop, and it wasn't closed. And suddenly the whole neighborhood thought, who has made that? So they call me up. So are you the painter? And the people of the art world, the people of the museum and the gallery world, they don't like it because it was only a work for the folk and not work for the elite. But later I make bigger mural paintings and I continued my exhibitions in galleries, different galleries. I had a small exhibition in Kobe in Japan. I had an exhibition in Indianapolis and Columbus, Ohio in the States. So I was going on with the normal exhibitions. But also the mural paintings are getting bigger. So I start in the pipe. And then I go further into the west side of the city. And then I go to the arches near the central station. It's a very long street. It's called Haarlemmer Houttuinen. And so I make a circle around Amsterdam. So I go from the west side to the east side of Amsterdam. And then from the east side to the pipe again back. And then there was a big attention of the media, but also big attention of the police department, all kind of groups of people. So I can make a painting in the police department, or I can make a painting in other companies. And everything was made without subsidy from the Dutch art system, because they don't like that artists make their own art without people. They said, yes, you can do it, and I give you some money from the government. So when I was back in my neighborhood at the end of that year, in the pipe again, this atelier against this beautiful upstairs, this beautiful gallery in early days was getting more famous. So but then the years of the 90s starting. And there were so much difficult things about commercial techniques, about the rent was going to be more because the everything was getting more expensive. You have to pay for everything more. So exactly on that moment, I met a very good manager. It's Michael Delbino. And He learned me very much about to handle bigger situations, how you can work with 10 people and not with one people or two or three people. So, yeah, we start a nice gallery in the pipe, and also an art rent studio. So, and that I think that was a very good idea to make the money, and to make the money continue also, so that it's a little bit more strong, getting strong. And we continue also the exhibitions in galleries and in other galleries, and also in companies, in design companies for that kind of things. And I think that's very important to stay on different lines in the community. So we can do something for a museum, we can do something for a clothes shop, we can do something for mobile tables, all kinds of things. But one thing is very important, that when you have art and merchandising, that kind of thing, that you have to look very good to the quality of the products. So there are, at the moment, many people still make figurative art and merchandising objects, but then they make a mistake, and they make the mistake that they don't look very well to the quality of the color of the printer of the project. So then it's better to do nothing with merchandising things. But sometimes it's possible to make a beautiful thing, just like the last week we make a tram, line 7. I saw you make a small film about that happening, and I think. Yeah, not line 7. Yeah. Oh, sorry, it's line 9. Yeah, I make a mistake. Excuse me. So it's very nice to see that you can work on such a quality and also so much aandacht. What is aandacht? So much aandacht from the people. So yeah, that's the moment I met you. So. For me, it's a little bit difficult to speak everything in English because I have to learn again.
it's fine. Yeah. You told me today that you had a new project that was going to go on with the trams. That you want to describe that a little bit?
Yeah. When we are going to the television studios of the TOS, we met a guy, and he worked in a company for commercials inside the tram. And in old Amsterdam trams, you have 10 poster places where you can hang on posters. And he like to make an exhibition of 120 paintings in 10 trams. And about 3 weeks, like nearly 4 weeks, it starts. And then this is the first exhibition in Holland I can make with 10 trams. So Amsterdam has maybe 30 different kind of lines, but 10 lines, it's a very big project. So I was yesterday when I heard it, I was really surprised, because we were sitting in the tram, Michael Delpino and me, we were sitting in the tram, and we said to each other, it should be a very nice idea to do something, things into the trams. And suddenly 1 week later he came. So it was beautiful to make this kind of ideas, because you have contact between public and the whole and art, and you know what's happened when you have to wait to the dentist. You like to see maybe art, or you like to see something else, and so in the tram, the people are sitting in the tram. They have to go to the dentist. They have to go to cook. They have to go to eat. They have to go to school. And that small kind of things can make the life a little bit more colorful, I think, yeah. So,
well, speaking of color, your paintings are so, maybe, how can I describe it, not Dutch-like in their colors. They seem so bright and brilliant. Is there something behind that?
I think there is not a real way of Northern Europe art or Southern Europe art, or Dutch art, or not Dutch art. I think when you look to the German artist Max Beckmann, he He's coming from Germany, but he used very heavy colors and very expressionistic work. When you look to Karel Appel, he's coming from Holland. He make very expressionistic, more barbaristic work. Fabrice is coming from Holland, but I'm a little bit Indonesian, a little bit Jewish, and a little bit mixed up Frisian, mixed up The Hague, a little bit Northern Italian blood, and I'm born in Amsterdam. So I think there is not a real Dutch art at the moment anymore. Okay, you have kunstgeschiedenis mensen, art history people, like Rosenthal, and they make a study about Northern European art and sound. But I don't believe that's true, because when you are digging in the ground here, you see Viking art, you see Celtic art, you see Germanic art, and okay, they don't have this fluorized color of a rose because they can't make it. But when you look to the expressionism, to the forms, it is international art. And you can see that quite well on this kind of paintings there, that the forms of the people are more in Indo-Germanic forms, Celtic forms. It's international. So I don't think that there is a really Dutch art. Okay, maybe in the 17th century we make very beautiful landscapes here. That's maybe typical Dutch thing. But yeah, there are so many other artists here. It's difficult to say what is Dutch art, I think, at the moment, yeah.
And speaking of that, there seems to be, through your paintings, a kind of an eroticism or a sensuality that... is this part of your form, part of your style? Would you describe it as such?
Yeah, I think so. My mother was, she make drawings always from a little bit small angels with round faces. And I think art is also a little bit about your genetic material. You took some pieces over from family. And also the parents of my parents make drawings a little bit like Charlie Thorop, maybe you know Charlie Thorop, a little bit from that kind of Indonesian Dutch hook came a little bit the language of forms, but also the sensuality, I think, is for me very important. And also irony is important, and also very much different things. Humor is very important to put inside the art, because humor, it's one of the most important relativations of the life. So I think here you see a little bit of drama from two ladies. They are swimming, but you never can see if they are laughing or they are a little bit afraid. You cannot see it, just like the Mona Lisa. She is not laughing, but she's also not afraid, but she's also not angry, but her face is like very much different characters of things. And I think that's important. When I'm in this exhibition, I make very much faces of ladies or people, and all the faces are a little bit different in stemming and different in voices. So maybe she's looking in the spiegel and she's looking for, am I beautiful enough? Or maybe she's looking just like Sneeuwwitje. Am I the most beautiful lady of the whole world? So it's all possible. All the different things are possible in one, in één beeld, zeg maar. And I think that's the game. Because the most different part of the art is how you can make in one beeld
painting.
In one painting, a piece of art about, and when you look there for 10 years, for 100 years, it has to be always boeiend, moet altijd boeiend, interesting. People, they make film and animations, they need 100 different pieces to make something nice. We have to make one piece, and then about 10 years or 100 years, it has to be interesting. Yeah.
So you think that in your art you'll find 100-year segments then, that people will be able to see.
I hope so. Not every painting is just like of that higher level. When you look to Picasso and he make 5,000 paintings, and maybe 1,000 are from the highest level. That's normal. Just when you are busy with arts, you cannot. De boog kan niet altijd gespannen zijn. Hè? Difficult is typical Dutch, but you can give your energy, and it's not every time possible to do the highest energy. But when the people is, when at the end of the life of a painter, you have to look to the highlights of what's the highest top he can make. So I hope that I can make a high top, and that I can and show the people of the world that making painting is an international language, international communication, without translating, without how you can say it. You have also one thing, conceptual art. At the moment you have conceptual art, everything is going about concept, ideas, but very much conceptual art is only interesting with a story and ID. So I'm not a conceptual artist, I'm a painter. So when I look to sometimes the conceptual art, I said, oh, it's very nice, but maybe you can better write a book, because you use visual things for things you can better write it down on characters. So that's we have to speak international language.
Well, there was a time in society where painting was the visual medium of expressing the ideas of the government, of the political idiom of what was going on, whatever was happening. And then at the turn of the century, well, there was photography, which took it over, and then cinema and television now that seems to express those political concerns. So what is the new role of art in that, in the context of painting?
I think this is a very interesting question. When you go at the beginning of the 80s, the role of the art was, you have the young Italian painters, the young German painters, also in Holland, they were a little bit rough painters, and their story was to make paintings about the Second World War, make paintings about misery, make paintings about all kinds of social, maatschappelijke things, social things. In the 90s, we don't have to do it, because the television does it. And when you look to the newspapers and you see everything, news about Somalia, news about Yugoslavia, the people don't like to have art like that on the wall anymore, because there's when you go to the newest direction rooms, then you see televisions all around, televisions, you go to the bureaus and you see televisions with numbers and cijfers. And we painters, we don't have to do it anymore. What we have to do, I think, is to make people, to make figurative, little bit abstract things for recognizing. When people work the whole day in New York, and there's a red race, and they are burned out at the end of the day, they come at home, but they are alone because they don't have a relationship. Or maybe they have a relationship, but they don't see their wife because the kids are going to the oppas, the things. And what happened then? When you're alone, you need a painting in your home, where you feel, hey, there is sitting somewhere else, and there is a soul in that painting. And that's important at the moment, I think, because then the energy is going down from this lady to this guy. And the herkenning, recognizing, is important, I think, for people. Now, at the moment, the people like to see live music, like to see pure things. At the moment, we don't sell prints very much. We sell real paintings, handmade paintings. People don't want any more reproductions. They don't want any more photographs, because about 5 years, everybody has a special computer in his home with internet and television combined, so you can make from everything reproductions. So that's what they don't like anymore. You have to make real art made by hand. That's, I think, what they like. Yeah. Yeah.
So tell me, what's in the future for you? What do you see?
Oh, I think the future it's a little bit dangerous period with milieu problems, bigger problems, vermits problems you cannot voorspellen. What is voorspellen? Very much things you cannot say what's going to happen, diseases, all kind of things we can met, but also very much more technical things you can use as artists. So I can use maybe a laser beam later, I can use maybe sometimes for the joke a computer to make things, and that is a grote speeltuin. That is for me it's a big child's place. So I'm an artist, he can work very well in chaos. When there is not a hierarchy of things, then I can function it quite well. So about now in the future, there are going to be so many different things and ideas, so you can make so many nice things and ideas, I think. But also there is very, very much misery. Yeah, problems with ecology, and you can make a drawing about a landscape, just like you see there, with fabrics and smell, and you see it's a dirty landscape. But I think now we don't have to do it. Now we have to make good nature, so you can see from, hey, that's nature. I think that's important for the future. That kind of things. That's more positive, showing vitale and positive things. And I called it also the last exhibition. I called Serendipity. That's also important to talk about it. Serendipity is art to make by coincidence. With using coincidence, you can make art, and that's also very important for the last thing to say. I think that's for the future very important to use that way of kind of thinking.
All right, Fabrice, thank you very much for talking to us today. Yeah. And this is David Heine. And look for his stuff. It's really good. Bye-bye.